Have you ever placed an object in Unreal Engine and wondered why it doesn't feel real? Maybe your metallic surfaces don't reflect correctly, your glass looks weird, or your foliage feels fake. The problem? Your materials aren't set up right. Today, I'm breaking down the 6 essential Unreal Engine materials: opaque, transparent, emissive, metallic, foliage, and subsurface scattering, and showing you how to create them properly. If you're doing games, cinematics, or interactive ArchViz, this video will help you take your materials to the next level. I'll guide you step by step to transform your material from looking like this to this. So stick around till the very end. I'm breaking down everything you need to know. I've got my Unreal Engine project open with a simple environment ready to show you exactly how materials work. To create a material in Unreal Engine, open the content browser, right-click, and select Material. I'll name this one Opaque. Now, double-click it, and the Material Graph Editor opens up. On the left side, under the Material section, you'll see key settings like Blend Mode, which is set to Opaque, and Material Domain, set to Surface. These define how our material interacts with light and rendering. For now, we'll keep these as they are and start building a basic material for our sphere. Inside the Material Graph Editor, hold 3 on your keyboard and left-click to add a Vector Constant. This will define our base color. To keep things organized, I'll right-click it, promote it to a parameter, and name it Base Color. Now let's connect this node to the base color input of our material to apply the color. To change the color, we can either double-click the node or adjust the default value on the left side of the material window. I'll set it to blue. Click Apply and... Now I'll close the material window and simply drag and drop this material onto the sphere to apply it. If you see an asterisk on the material, it means it hasn't been saved. Always make sure to save your materials to apply changes properly. Right now, the surface looks basic. But what if we apply this material to the floor and want it to look glossy? To make the surface glossy, we need to control its roughness and specular values. Roughness determines how smooth or rough the surface appears, while specular controls how much light it reflects. In the Material Graph Editor, hold S on your keyboard and left-click to add a scalar parameter. I'll name this one Specular. Now I'll duplicate it by pressing Ctrl plus D and rename the copy to Roughness. To rename a parameter manually, just select it and press F2 on your keyboard. Now let's connect these nodes to their respective material inputs. By default, both values are set to 0, meaning they have no effect. To make the sphere glossy, we need to use the lower value on Roughness. I'll set it to 0.2, but there's no visible change yet. That's because specular plays the main role in controlling reflections. So, let's set the specular value to 0.4. Now you can see reflections appearing in the Material Editor viewport. To apply the changes in the main scene, just click Apply. Now we have a simple but nice-looking sphere in our scene. If you want a matte plastic material instead, just set the roughness value to 1. Now the sphere loses its gloss and looks completely matte. Now that we've covered roughness and specular, let's move on to metallic materials. Let's create a new material and name it Metallic. Just like before, I'll open it, add a vector constant for the base color, and a scalar parameter for metalness. I right-clicked the scalar parameter and selected Connect to Metallic, just to show you that you can connect nodes this way too. It's a quicker method, especially when working with materials that have a lot of texture maps. Now let's set the metallic value to 1. And our sphere will turn into a metallic ball. Click Apply to see the result in the viewport. But fully metallic objects don't reflect light properly on their own, so we need to adjust the roughness value to make it look like a reflective chrome ball. I duplicated the metallic node, renamed it Roughness to keep things organized, and connected it to the roughness input, just making sure everything is linked correctly. Now, if I set the value to 0.1, and click Apply, the sphere transforms into a sleek, reflective chrome ball with realistic reflections. Now that you understand specular, roughness, and metalness, let's move on to emissive materials, one of the most useful material for creators. First, I'll create a new material and apply it to the third sphere in our scene. Then, I'll open the Material Editor and adjust my viewport to keep the sphere clearly visible. Let's add a vector constant, convert it to a parameter and name it Emissive Color. Then, I'll connect it to the Emissive Color input in the material and set it to a random color. After clicking Apply, the material is set, but to see the sphere actually emit light, we need a darker scene. I'll hold Ctrl plus L and rotate the sun downward to dim the lighting. Now we can see the sphere emitting light, but the intensity is too low. To control it, I'll open the material and add a scalar parameter named Intensity. Since the material has only one emissive input, we need to combine these two nodes. I'll add a multiply node, connect emissive color to A, intensity to B, and then connect the multiply output to emissive color. The default intensity value is set to 0, which is why the sphere turned dark. Let's set it to 1 to make it visible. To make it even brighter, I'll increase it to 5. Now the sphere is glowing intensely. Now we can adjust the color in real time using this parameter. Everything updates instantly, thanks to Lumen. Let's reset the sun's position, and now I'll set up a material using custom textures. First, I'll create a new folder in the content browser to keep my imported textures organized. Just drag and drop the textures into Unreal Engine. Now I'll use them to show you how to set up a material properly. I'll select the first sphere, then from the Details panel, I'll double-click on its material to open the material editor. A texture typically includes a base color, also known as albedo in technical terms, or sometimes called diffuse color. Most textures also come with a normal map. The one I downloaded from Polyhaven includes a displacement map and a roughness map as well. Some textures may also have metallic, specular, and other maps. Now I'll drag and drop the diffuse map into the material graph and connect it to the base color input. Next, I'll add the normal map and connect it to the normal input. Finally, I'll bring in the roughness map and connect it to the roughness input. After applying it, our sphere now has a great-looking rock material. But we still have one more map left, displacement. Drag the displacement map into the graph editor. Right-click on it and try to connect it. You'll notice there's no displacement input available. To enable it, go to the Details panel on the left, search for Tessellation, and under the Nanite section, check Enable Tessellation. Now the displacement input will appear on the Material node. Connect the displacement map to the displacement input, hit Apply, and now our material looks perfect with enhanced details and depth. In this gray rock texture pack, we had a roughness map. But if it wasn't available, we could use a scalar parameter to manually control the surface's roughness or glossiness based on our needs. Let's duplicate our old specular parameter and connect the new one to roughness. I'll set the roughness value to around 0.2, and now the texture will look wet and glossy. Try adjusting the specular value as well to fine-tune the look. Different values will affect how light interacts with the surface, helping you get the perfect result. Let's use the same texture for the metallic sphere first, and then we'll apply it to the emissive sphere to see how it behaves in different material types. I've applied the diffuse map, and now I'll drag and drop the displacement map into the graph editor. If we search for tessellation, there are no results, because we need to select the material node first to access its features. Texture nodes have their own unique settings in the Details panel, which I'll cover in an advanced material guide video. All the texture maps are connected, but our sphere still doesn't look metallic. That's because the roughness map from our texture pack has a high roughness value. To fix this, I'll use a scalar parameter to lower the roughness, making the sphere look properly metallic. If the metallic value is maxed out at 1, our diffuse map will barely be visible, so in most cases, it's best to keep the metallic value slightly lower than 1 for a more balanced look. Now we have two spheres using the same textures but with different materials. The first one looks like glossy, wet rocks, while the second has a metallic rock surface. We can also create custom roughness or metallic maps for our objects, but I'll cover that only if this video gets a good response. Now let's move on to the third sphere and apply all the textures to our emissive material. For the emissive color, let's use the diffuse map to make the rocks glow. Drag the texture into the graph editor, connect it to the multiply node, and delete the old constant node. Now click apply, and you'll see the sphere emitting a bit of light. Let's lower the sun in the scene. And as we increase the intensity, the light becomes more visible on the floor. And that's how you can create materials with custom textures for your games and ArchViz projects, giving your scenes more realism and depth. Now let's move on to creating a realistic glass material with proper reflections and refractions. Shout out to the guy from Sketchfab for creating this awesome table, which I'll be using to demonstrate our glass material. I've imported this model into my scene without textures, so I can show you how to create a proper glass material from scratch. Let's open the glass material. In the material editor, the first step is to adjust the settings in the details panel. Change the blend mode from opaque to translucent to enable transparency. Also enable two-sided to make the material visible from both sides. You can already see the changes taking effect in the preview sphere. Scroll down to the translucency section and change the lighting mode to surface translucency volume. Next, find the refraction section to control how light bends through the glass. Change the refraction method from none to index of refraction. Now we have the refraction input available in our material. Now let's add a vector constant to control the glass color. I'll convert it to a parameter so we can adjust it easily. Set the color to white, and just like before, add scalar parameters to control metalness and roughness for better customization. Set the metallic value to 1 and roughness to 0. Glass has opacity, so I'll duplicate the roughness node, rename it to opacity, and connect it to the opacity input. Setting the value to 0.5 will make the glass transparent. Finally, let's set the refraction. Right-click and search for the linear interpolate node. Select the linear interpolate node from the utility section, then connect it to the refraction input. Now hold one on your keyboard and left-click to add a constant node, set its value to 1, and connect it to the A input on the Lerp node. Now duplicate the constant node and connect it to the B input on the Lerp node. This will be our refraction value. Set it to 1.52, which is the index of refraction for glass. The glass sphere looks almost perfect, but we still need to refine the alpha input on the Lerp node to get more accurate refraction. For the alpha input, we need to add a Fresnel node. This is because Fresnel controls how light interacts with the surface at different viewing angles, making the refraction more realistic. Now apply and save your material, then close the material window. And if you're disappointed with the result, don't worry. Just go to your post-process volume, search for translucency, and change the type from raster to ray tracing. Now you have the amazing glass you were looking for. And if we increase the refraction rays, the glass material will look even better. Try different values, and you'll find even better results. 96.6% of you are just watching without subscribing. I just saved your glass material from disappointment. Hit that sub button. Don't be ungrateful. This is the first video on my channel where I've mentioned it, and you can make it the last by showing your support. And this was for Lumen, but some of our fellow creators might be using path tracing for rendering. For example, if I switch the lit mode to path tracing, the glass looks completely white, not ideal in most cases. To fix this, just open your glass material. And here, simply change your base color from white to dark gray, hit apply, and now your glass material looks perfect in path tracing as well. These are the opaque and translucent materials, but some materials, like skin and plants, don't just reflect light like metal or glass. Instead, light goes inside them, spreads around, and then comes back out. This is called subsurface scattering. It's what makes skin look soft and natural instead of plastic. Unreal Engine lets us add this effect to make things look more realistic. Shout out to Urender for absolutely nailing the best looking subsurface scattering render. Go check out their channel. Link will be in description. So, back to Unreal Engine. Let me quickly show you how to enable subsurface scattering in your material. Here I have a sphere with all the texture maps ready to go. On the left side, change the shading model from default lit to subsurface. And now you'll see a new input for subsurface color in your material. And if you click Apply and check the sphere in the viewport, it looks completely white. Since we need this for skin or foliage, let's maximize the material window and first add a scalar parameter named Strength. Connect this node to opacity and then set its value to 1. This value works in an inverted way. Lower values make the effect stronger, while higher values reduce it. Now we need to set a subsurface color, which is important because it defines how light scatters inside the material. Instead of just bouncing off like a regular surface, light penetrates and spreads, creating that soft, glowing effect you see in skin, leaves, and wax. So again, we need a vector constant to control the subsurface color. Convert the vector constant to a parameter and name it SSS color, so we can easily adjust the subsurface scattering color. And we also need one more scalar parameter to adjust how strong the effect is. I'll just duplicate the strength node and rename it brightness. And now hold D from your keyboard and left click to add a divide node. We're using a divide node instead of a multiply node this time because subsurface scattering behaves differently. When we multiply values, we make things stronger or brighter. But for SSS, we need to control how much light passes through the surface. Dividing helps us fine-tune the effect by reducing the intensity in a more natural way, making the scattering look more realistic. Now let's connect the SSS color node to A and the brightness node to B in the divide node. Then connect the divide node to the subsurface color input. This will let us control both the color and intensity of the subsurface scattering effect. Let's apply the changes. Since the color was set to black, the sphere looks just like it did with the default lit shader. But now I'll change the color to a skin tone, and you can see the difference. We can also control the brightness. Remember, lower values make it brighter, while higher values make it more subtle or darker. And strength has a much bigger impact on the surface than brightness. But don't just take my word for it. Try different values for both, and you'll find the perfect balance for your models. And we're done with all the basics of materials in Unreal Engine. But before we wrap up, let me give you one last tip: material instances. Instead of creating new materials from scratch every time, you can create a material instance from your base material, allowing you to tweak parameters like color, roughness, and brightness in real time without reloading shaders. It's a huge time saver. All the nodes we made as parameters in the base material are now available in this instance. Anytime you need this for another object, just duplicate the instance and apply it. No need to create a new material from scratch. And if you're interested in learning about master materials, I'll leave a link to my master material video in the description.